Hello. So thank you for having me here. So the talk is entitled Malware Goes to the Movies. So just to give a little bit history about the talk and how it came about, one summer day, my wife asked me to download a movie from the internet. And I fired up a torrent client, went, made myself a cup of tea, and went about my business. An hour later, I came back and was very happy. The movie downloaded. I double-clicked on the movie, and I got a strange pop-up saying I'm missing a bunch of codecs. So I thought, well, that's strange. I'm not missing any codecs. And being in the security profession, I was paranoid and decided to investigate a little bit more. And this talk is about what I discovered. So the outline of a talk is as follows. So first I'll give you an overview about how malware spreads through image, music, and video files. Then we're going to look at some malware media trends. What are the types of attacks that people are using? How does the malware spread? What are some of the statistics about the spread of malware through the media files? Then we're going to look at some attack vectors and detailed case studies. And finally, we will conclude the talk by examining how to actually protect yourself, how to make modifications to your system to prevent these types of attacks from happening. But you know, before I begin, let me just do a quick poll by a raise of hands. Who here has ever watched a video or downloaded a video from the internet? So I have. So a couple of people are shy, but I'm sure they did download the video. Okay, how about music files? Did anybody ever download music from the internet by a show of hands? So again, same people are shy, and I'm sure everybody downloaded image files from the internet. So, you know, the question is, why use media to spread malware? And the answer is obvious, because everybody downloads music, everybody downloads videos, everybody looks at images on the internet. So, you know, if you look at some statistics, just in December alone, according to CNN, in 2009, 14.3 billion videos were viewed in America just in the month of December. Also, if you look at the screenshots on the right, a lot of music companies are very worried about the CD-DVD business because people no longer buy CDs and DVDs online. They just download the music off the internet. So, for example, in Britain alone, according to The Guardian, 7 million people at least use illegal music downloads from the internet. Also, just, you know, if you do a simple statistic, you type in Angelina Jolie in Google image search, you get 5.6 million images of Angelina Jolie. How many of those images are legitimate? And how many of them could potentially be using some type of attack to infect your computer? So the numbers are fairly staggering. Everybody looks at images, everybody looks at music, everybody views videos online. So it's only natural that the bad guys are gonna try to use these methods of propagating the malware to infect your computer. So in my company, we do security awareness training. So during the security awareness trainings, I show them the picture on the right. And the picture has four parts. And each part corresponds to an action. And I ask people, do you think it's safe to do it? So on the left-hand upper corner, you see you get a pop-up saying update to iTunes. So you get an update. And almost everybody who I ask thinks it's safe, almost 98% of the people. It's generally safe. Then I ask them, okay, let's say there's an ugly looking screensaver that your friend sent you, and you want to install that screensaver on your computer. Do you think it's safe to do? And only 10% of people think it's safe to install a screensaver. It's a program that you install on your computer, so people are naturally getting more educated and becoming more distrustful. Then on the right-hand bottom corner, I say, okay, what about an internet accelerator? Let's say you come across a web page which tells you, here's an internet accelerator, you download it, and it makes your computer a lot more fast, a lot faster. And nobody thinks it's safe. They still do it, but during the security awareness, they think it's not safe. And then I show them the left bottom corner, which says you go to a friend's blog, and there's a YouTube movie embedded on a friend's blog. Is it safe to look at the movie? And at that point, you know, eyeballs start rolling, people are not sure, but they wake up usually during the presentation, and some of them say yes, some of them say no, so roughly it's a 50-50% breakdown. And most of these people are actually IT professionals. They know what they're doing. They're not an average user. They work with computers on a daily basis. So out of those people, 50% think that YouTube movies and a friend's blog are perfectly safe to watch. You know, if you poll a regular consumer, what do you think the answer would be? I would bet that most of them would think it's safe to watch. So now let's look at some malware trends. So the statistics is there. We view media, most people think it's safe to download music, videos, and look at images online. So some interesting malware trends which I noticed. So a lot of the time attacks are not targeted, actually most of the time. So what that means is they're going to just try to infect a large population. They're not gonna target a specific organization or specific person. Typically they just put it out there and hope to lure as many people as they can. The two typical techniques which are used for infecting people's computers are social engineering. You need to get a person to click on a video. You need to get a person to listen to music. You need to get a person to look at the image file. There's some degree of social engineering always involved. And another technique which is commonly used is black hat search engine optimization. So what those guys are gonna do is they're gonna poison Google search results or Yahoo search results. So you could be searching for an image of Yellowstone National Park, as I was about a month ago. And so I searched for Yellowstone National Park in Google Images, and in the first page, you get a bunch of images. And I clicked on one of them, and immediately my antivirus complained that it's a potentially malicious image that could infect my computer. So what the bad guys are gonna do is they're gonna use a program such as Hroomer, for example, which is gonna go and bombard different blogs with hidden links to the particular site that they want people to go to. And then when you search for a particular keyword, such as elections, celebrity names, some type of latest events, you're gonna come up with a site which looks legit. But when you go there, you're gonna look at an image or look at a video which is actually gonna be designed to infect your computer. So a rough malware breakdown, it's very rough, it's not mathematical, but from my observations, a majority of the attacks usually happen through videos. The next category is music, and the last 20% is images. And the methods of infection are typically through news site imitations. So I'm gonna show you a couple of slides later in the presentation, but typically what people are gonna do is they're gonna set up lookalike sites which imitate news sites. And you go there, it looks completely like a news site, but it's actually a site designed to infect your computer. Another common way of infecting people using media malware is P2P sites. Everybody shares music, video, so they're gonna try to infect video and music files on your computer or upload infected files on a P2P sites, hoping that you're gonna download them. And a third component, and again, I'm gonna go into more detail about each of these sites, is social sites, such as Facebook, MySpace, LinkedIn. Well, LinkedIn not so much, but Facebook, MySpace. They're gonna be usually spread through those type of sites. So a little bit of statistics. So if you look at the graph on the right-hand corner by Kaspersky, the total number of malicious programs targeting social networking sites is going up significantly. So Kaspersky ran a study, and what they did is they compared two ways of getting people to infect their computer. In one way, they sent an email with a malicious attachment to different people. Well, they didn't send it, but they studied how likely people are to click on it. So in one way, people received a malicious attachment, such as a holiday greeting card, a PDF file, an image file from your buddy, and they measured how many of those people would actually open up a greeting card, an image, which contained malware. And it was only 1%, 1% effectiveness. So 1% of the people who received the attachment usually clicked on it. If you compare it with the effectiveness of infecting people through social sites, the difference is staggering. It's 10% effectiveness. So if your friend on Facebook sends you a message saying click here on this link to view a video, or sends you an instant message, or posts it in his profile, 10% of the people click on it, so it's 10% more effective because people on social networking sites feel like they're in real life. They connect to their friends, they talk to their friends, they feel they lose any type of inhibitions, so they're a lot more trustworthy than they are in opening attachments. And that's why social networking sites are a common distribution channel for the media malware as well as other type of malware. Breaking news video. So if you look again at statistics, according to Kaspersky, during quarter one of 2010, if you take any type of newsworthy event, any type, Gulf oil spill, the release of Avatar movie, Moscow bombings, earthquake in Haiti, recent elections in the United States, any type of newsworthy event has been exploited by the bad guys. What they did is they took that event and set up a lookalike site to talk about that particular event, and people Googled for it and they hit the site and got infected. So setting up breaking news videos, setting up lookalike blogs and lookalike web pages is a very common method of infection these days. And according to an article by SC Magazine, out of 100 million blog posts, the ESOF team uncovered about 700,000 malicious YouTube lookalike pages. So that's a 0.7% ratio. I did a study of my own. I have a custom tool which I implemented, which looks at the torrent files and downloads a video piece by piece and then checks if the video contains any malicious scripts. So there's an interesting statistic. So I took one movie called Ghost Rider by Roman Polanski. And before the DVD release, so before the DVD actually came out, 10 out of 570 videos didn't contain malware. So 1.75% didn't contain malware. And almost 98% of videos that you found online were malicious. After the DVD release, now a DVD release is out there, it's much easier to copy, the statistics obviously improves. So after the DVD release, 66% of the videos were clean, but 44% were still infected that you could download from torrent sites. Image files, so we talked about video, YouTube imitations. Now we talk about image files. So it's a big component. So typically in the image files, the different approaches you would take. One approach is to exploit the GDI buffer overflow vulnerability in some images, which Microsoft did not patch until a couple of years ago. Another way was to nestle the PHP script code into the text comments of the images, and some web servers, when you clicked on the image, they would actually start executing the PHP code. So there was a big spike in the number of malformed images which were designed to take over people's computers. So this is just a high-level overview from a bird's eye view. So now let's look at some actual attack vectors. What are the ways that malware uses to infect people's computers? So we talked about three different types, right? So type number one is Microsoft video and music format. Type number two is images. And type number three is YouTube lookalike videos. So in the case of Microsoft video and music, typically one of two things is used. I'm going to describe it in more detail. But typically they use a URL and exit script injection command, or they abuse the DRM digital rights management functionality which is present in Microsoft video and music files. They all do renaming tricks like rename movie.avi to movie.avi.exe or rename an image to angelina.jpg.exe, but that's not a particularly interesting way of attacking, so we're not going to discuss that. In images, I mentioned the GDI buffer overflows and the PHP commands and comments. In the YouTube videos use Flash, so the YouTube lookalike videos also use Flash. And Flash has different type of script commands which allow you to access a particular URL, which is being exploited by the attackers. Also, there are a gazillion different Adobe vulnerabilities which could be used to take over a person's computer. So, as I mentioned, typically for video and music, particular person's account, it could write messages to people, it could post on a wall. You know how on Facebook you have different likes? You can say, I like music, I like Beatles, etc. It could even upload a particular link in the like section which says, I like a really cool thing to do in New York City. And when somebody clicks on your friend's page and says, what is that thing? I want to see what he likes. It's going to take you to a malicious URL. So what this virus is going to do is it's going to often send intriguing messages to friends of people. So you log in one day and you get an intriguing message from your friend which says, candid camera prank. And it's your friend who sent you a message. You click on it, it's a video, and it's a YouTube lookalike video, but not really a YouTube video. So once you click on it, it's gonna say, you're missing a particular codec, click here. You click on it because your friend sent it to you, and then you infect your computer. Here's another example which I analyzed in great depth. So I mentioned to you the fact that there were a lot of news site imitations. So the site is actually still active. I think it's still active as of last week. video.report-cnn.com. I mean, the domain is report-cnn.com, but it looks identical to CNN. A reminder, Aaron Andrews was a United States reporter who was photographed secretly in a hotel room by a perpetrator, and there was a lawsuit against the guy who secretly videotaped her, and apparently a lot of people were searching for that video online because they couldn't get it. And shortly thereafter, the site appeared. And you know, there was a video of a naked woman. It looks identical to CNN. The site is video.report-cnn.com. And you click on a video and you get a message right there on the bottom which says live video player blocked, that your pop-up blocker blocked access to the video player. Click here to enable the pop-up. And there was a lot of interesting things about this particular example. It did some novel things. First of all, typically when you click on these videos, the video doesn't play. In this case, when you clicked on the pop-up blocker, the video actually played, and you saw some type of a woman undressing in a hotel room. And then the video finished playing, and you went about your business. You didn't notice anything. And a lot of the time, the attackers are sloppy, so the video doesn't play, so you get suspicious. Here, the video played, but it also infected your computer. And depending on the computer, depending on the region where you're coming from, it would download different types of malware onto your computer. So it would detect if you're using a Mac, and if you're using a Mac, it would download OS X Jolof Trojan, and if you're using a Windows, it would download one of several different Trojans on your computer. So if you look at the HTML source code of the site, you know, I looked at the source code, and the source code is just using iframes to embed the content from CNN website into the site. The only single difference about this particular site is that command right there, which says embed SRC HTTP media player for obd.com. So everything is embedded from CNN, everything is legit, except that video in the middle. And the video is served from media player.forobd.com. So I got curious, I did a little bit more analysis, and a lot of people fell for this. If you look at the traffic report, it's right there on the top, video.report.cnn.com. There are a lot of sites on Yahoo, Bing in particular. Google still didn't, Google did a little bit of cleaning up, but a lot of the sites actually link to this particular video. So on Bing, there are about 382 sites linking to that particular site. So you would go to one of the sites, and it's often a legitimate site. It's often a legitimate site. In a comment section, somebody is gonna say, oh, check here on CNN to look at the video. And you know, if you do a simple lookup through Multigo of the media player for obd.com site, you're gonna find out that the guy actually created a lot of similar sites dedicated to sex, breaking news, online gambling, looking for jobs. So the same guy created a lot of sites. You would go look for a job or look for online casino, and you would potentially get infected because the same guy created a network of sites. And by the way, he was really smart. Not only is he downloading different type of malware on your computer, but they use all kinds of interesting mitigation techniques. So when I was first analyzing it, I was not careful enough. I was using my own computer to access it, access the particular site, which is media player for obd.com. And after a while, I was getting completely clean pages, which looked completely legit. And I thought, well, this is strange. I know it was serving malware. So then I fired up the Tor client, changed my IP address, looked again, and obviously I got the malware. So they actually remember the IP addresses of the people who hit it. And if you hit it too many times, they figure out you're trying to analyze it, so they're going to start serving completely normal pages to you. So example number two, ASF exploits. So ASF is a Microsoft format for videos and music files. So typically, the files have an extension ASF, WMA, WMV. So these are just video and music files. Now, the interesting part about Windows is if you rename one of these files into AVI, MP3, whatever usual video format you have, and you double click on it, it's still gonna play, but it's gonna interpret it as an ASF format. Now, ASF format, the difference between a lot of other video formats and ASF is that ASF has rich functionality. It allows you to embed script commands inside of it. So, and by the way, not only Windows supports it. There are a lot of players, Real Player, MPlayer, Zune, Flip for Mac, QuickTime, Linux, FFmpeg. So it's not just Windows, which has these issues. Two interesting parts about the format is, number one, it allows you script commands. So you can actually embed script commands to download a particular web page using URL and exit in your movie or a music file. And also it has a framework for digital rights management. And a format is pretty simple. It's just a bunch of blocks and byte sequences identified by a GUID. So you have a GUID which says, okay, the next thing which follows is a script command. The next thing which follows is a video block. Is a block of video bytes. And so parsing it is actually really simple. I'll talk about URL and exit in a second, but DRM, there's another interesting part about DRM. So DRM is digital rights management. It's a framework which Microsoft put around their files. And typically it allows you to control the distribution of your file. So typically what's gonna happen is, if you look at the box in the right-hand corner, what the person is going to do, you're an author of a video. So you're going to encode the video with particular licensing information, and then a consumer tries to play the video. And a consumer is that box on the very bottom. And the consumer is gonna try to play the video, and what the video is going to do is it's going to instruct the media player to go and contact a licensing server. And a licensing server is that box on the right with a key in it. So the media player is going to send a request to the licensing server and get back some type of response and decide if the video can be played or not. So there are a couple of really interesting things about the DRM protocol here. Number one, a lot of communication is actually happening over HTTP. It's not encrypted. Point number two, the licensing server can actually send an HTML message back to the media player, which is going to be displayed to the end user. And the reasoning behind it is you click on a protected video and you need a license to play the video. You want to display a message which looks nice to the user. For example, put an avatar logo in the pop-up box which you're presenting. So the licensing server is actually going to, you know, is going to send you that HTML message, and the media player is going to blindly display it on the user's computer. And there's no authentication happening between the media player and the licensing server. So there's no authentication. So you could set up your own web server and point the URL to go to your web server, and the web server is going to return to you HTML, and that HTML is going to be displayed on a user's computer without any question. So that's the attack scenario. So the basic way it's going to work is an attacker is going to set up a web server, and the web server is going to return malicious HTML, and there's going to be a DRM marker in the video. You click on a video, and the player is going to contact the malicious DRM server, and it's going to tell you what HTML to display. So there are multiple examples of Trojans which use it. There's an example of a WMV downloader A. There's an example of a WMV downloader B. They could tell you to install a codec or download a legitimate license. So here's an example. You click on a music file containing Ludwig van Beethoven's Symphony No. 9. You play it, and all of a sudden, in the middle of a music, you get a pop-up that you're missing a particular codec. You just listen to a little bit of a symphony, so you want to listen to the rest. So you click on it, and it continues playing, but you just infected your computer. Here's another example. Instead of a missing codec, you could actually threaten the user to accept the license terms. So this type of malware was very smart. You downloaded a video or music file, you clicked on it, it created a pop-up box on the left, which says copyright violation, copyrighted content detected. And it actually gave a link to a site which they set up, which says icpponline.com. And the site looked legit, and it said, you know, you downloaded piracy, and it's against the law. If you don't want us to pursue legal action, click here and pay $100 fine. And it looked completely legit, so a lot of people would go and pay $100 fine and play the video, and the attackers would collect the money. So, example of social engineering. So that's how DRM abuse is used. Now, URL and exit. So the script commands inside Microsoft video and image files. So if you look at the website, there's a snippet which says, the reason for script commands is to enhance users' viewing experience. So the idea is that you're gonna be viewing a video, and in the middle of a video, you might wanna pop up a website to a user to enhance the user's viewing experience. I can't really necessarily imagine a scenario where it would be a good idea, but there might be. The bad guys in the meantime are actively abusing it. So in the middle of a video, they're gonna inject a URL and exit command, which is gonna bring up a particular website to a user as he watches a video or listens to music. So here's an example, and the picture is due to ScanSafe. They did a really good analysis of this Win32 ASF hijacker. They get the credit for this. But the basic idea is it's actually a really interesting type of malware. And let's assume your computer is infected with this malware. What this malware is going to do is it's going to search your computer for all the video and music files in ASF format. If it finds some music and video files not in the ASF format, it's going to automatically convert them to ASF format. Then it's going to inject URL and exit commands into your music and video files in the middle of the movie or music files. And then what it's going to do is it's going to disable the URL and exit functionality, the protection technique which I talk about, on your computer. And the reason it does that is that when you view this video and music files, they're gonna look completely normal to you. You're not gonna notice anything different. But the reasoning is you're going to use P2P or torrent to share these files. So you're gonna be sharing these files with other people, and these files on your computer are gonna be infected. And you're gonna be infecting other people's computers without knowing it. If you look at the size difference, it's very subtle. You know, for example, Queen Bohemian Rhapsody, it was 83003 kilobytes. After infection, it's 8546 kilobytes. It's only 500 kilobyte footprint. So alternatively, instead of you sharing the music and video files yourself, attackers could upload videos themselves. So they could poison the search results, as I mentioned, and upload the videos they created. Now, the good news about these videos is that usually they're pretty lazy. So they're not gonna inject the URL and exit command in the middle of a video, they're gonna inject it in the beginning. And the video itself is gonna be fake. So it's really easy to detect you've been duped. You download the video of a movie, you click on it, and you can't see it because it's not a real video. So in this case, detecting them becomes pretty easy. So, and when you download these videos, they do some simple engineering techniques. Sometimes they're gonna do something as simple as include a readme.txt.link file, which is really a link. You click on it, you infect yourself. More often than not, they're gonna just, you know, they're just gonna try to use the URL and exit injection. And it's the same idea as with DRM. You click on a video, it's gonna pop up a box saying Windows Media Player. Click here to download. So that's the video files. So the last part about the case studies is the JPEG GDI exploit. So that's the image files exploit. And this is actually old news, but it's still being used because a lot of people don't patch their computers. So it's still is it's not a sequential download. Torrent is a distributed hash table, right? It assumes that different people have different pieces, so it's going to go look up in the whatever glossary, send out requests for different pieces of the file to different types of people. So what I needed to do is I needed to tweak the download to be sequential. It's going to be slower because it's not going to download random pieces. It's going to download piece number one, number two, number three, etc. But after you tweak that, the rest of the change is very easy. So you tweak the download to be sequential, and then you just use a basic string search, Boyer-Moore string search, to look for any URL and exit or LA info commands. Once you find the command in the video, what you do is you extract the URL to which that command points. And then I take that URL and I send a request to the servers of Web of Trust to tell me how trustworthy is that particular URL. If that URL is not trustworthy, I'm going to claim that the video is malicious. And this is the URL where the tool is available, but you know it's still in alpha stage. But I uploaded the Python code over there. And if you look at the output, here's an output. So for example, I'm downloading the Ghostwriter AVI file. So it says sequential torrent download. So it's downloading pieces 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And then I'm going to say, OK, now search for malicious script commands in the video. And it found that there's a URL and exit command starting at position 1939. So in the beginning of the video file, just 2,000 bytes afterwards. And then it extracts a URL, freak torrents info log3, and it checks the reputation of a URL using Web of Trust. And you know, we get a non-trustworthy URL, so we're not going to proceed. Another interesting idea about how to detect malicious files was proposed by Trusted Source. So this is an area for future research. But they had a pretty cool idea. They said, if you think about a video, it has particular properties. When you inject text commands into a video, it's going to change the entropy of the byte stream. Because text commands use just alphanumeric characters. They're predictable, so you know by looking for the entropy deviations in the byte stream, you can detect sometimes if a video is malicious. Also, if you look at the end of the video, usually the video is just padded to make it large enough. So the padding is usually repetitive, so it's not going to have enough entropy, right? So you could use that type of criteria to detect malicious videos as well. So conclusion. Staying away from shady or illegal websites is not necessarily going to keep you safe this day. A lot of the time, you're actually going to be infected by going to news sites which look completely legitimate. Or maybe you're going to download a music file from your friend, and it's also going to potentially infect your computer. Usually, the good news is some type of human interaction is needed. It's not just going to take over your computer. You have to click on something. So being aware of tricks like misencoded codec trick, missing license, already puts you on top of a game. Another recommendation is disable unneeded functionality. Go and change this registry setting on your computer. That's going to solve a lot of the problems. And you can download and play with the video searcher tool to look for malicious scripts. It's still alpha, but if anybody wants to play with the code and contribute, you're more than welcome. So this is it. And I think we have 5 minutes for questions.
Exactly. Well done. Yeah, 5 minutes for questions. So I hope you're scared enough to actually follow his advice. Yes, any questions?
I think there's a question in the back.
Do you have a checklist for users, what they can do to prevent these things? I mean, we've heard today how to disable this function, the URL and exit function, but what can I tell other people? Is there any kind of tool which checks if you could be vulnerable, or if you're still vulnerable to the GDI JPEG exploit?
That's a good question. Regarding GDI exploits specifically, yeah, there's a tool which I mentioned. So there's a GDI scan tool, so you can just Google for it, and it's going to scan your hard drive and look for vulnerable copies of the DLL. But if you opt to, if you upgrade your patches, if you opt to Service Pack 2, you're going to be safe, most likely. Regarding the other attacks, you're not going to be safe. So what I would tell your users is education, right? Tell them that it's not necessarily safe to just download videos and music files in a work environment. At home, you can do whatever you want, as long as you're aware. But in a work environment, you need to tell people about the risks and educate them. So that's really the best protection. Some antiviruses detected, but not many. So, like for example, McAfee, it detected the WMV downloader when I downloaded the malicious WMV file, but a lot of the other things are not detected. So you know, if you want to do a simple check without downloading a tool, and if you're a tech-savvy person, what I do is I download a video, I open up the video in a hex editor, and I just scroll down like a few pages and see if there's padding and if there's URL and exit command in the beginning. If there is, then it's likely that you downloaded a malicious video. If there's not, then most likely it's safe.
Any more questions? What about the already downloaded files that are on the hard disks? Any scanner for that? I mean, you fire up a hex editor and you know what to look for, but...
Yeah, so this video searcher tool, I mean, it's still in alpha stage, so I need to work on it a little bit more, but this video searcher tool, so when I said alpha, the part which is alpha is actually downloading the torrent pieces, because torrent download is a little bit sequential, so I did... is a little tricky to get right, so I didn't get all the details correctly. But on a hard disk, it should work actually well. You can just point it to a particular file, and it's going to look for those script commands and tell you if they're present or not. So that would be pretty easy to do. So I think the good part is if you already have downloaded things on your computer, usually they're going to prompt you to go install something else, but not always. So. There's no perfect answer.
There's no site, report site where those URLs that you find that you're being redirected to are to be seen?
So there are some report sites, but for video and music files, unfortunately, there are no easy report sites that you can go to at the moment. It's still a very, it's still a very unexplored area, like a lot of people, and the goal of this talk was to raise attention to it, but it still seems like bad guys, again, ahead of the curve, they're using it actively, but there are very few security researchers at the moment who are actually looking into this.
Any questions?
Are users using, for example, VLC safe from those kind of attacks? Because I think they re-implement their decoders and everything, so they probably don't support URL and exit and those kind of functionalities. Do you know?
Yeah, I mean, somebody asked me a similar question. I don't know off the top of my head. It depends if it implements the full stack of ASF. Right, so if it implements URL and exit commands, then no, you're not safe. If it doesn't, then you are. So like I said, there are many different types of players affected. It's just not all player. So the players I listed, they support ASF. So if you're using like MMPEG, etc., then you're going to be vulnerable. But that particular one, I don't know about.
Okay, thanks.
Well, if there's no further questions, then... I would like to ask, thank you first of all for this very interesting talk to raise awareness to upcoming difficulties. Thank you.